Hello.
I'm Gregory Martin Makoska. My middle name, Martin, honors my uncle, Martin Olander. Today, we'll explore his and my mother's family tree, beginning with their paternal Olander branch. My grandfather, Herb Olander, was 100% Scandinavian because both his parents, my great-grandparents, were born in Sweden. Let's take a look at his family tree. The Swedes are avid builders of family trees, and with their help on Ancestry.com, I've traced the Olanders back to Lars Halvardsson, born in Sweden in the mid-16th century. Of course, we know his father's first name was Halvard, because in those days, a Swedish son's surname was their father's first name with son added. Daughters would add daughter. Our great-grandmother Anna Olander's father, Hans, didn't use son, but chose the surname Ekelund. This name came down from a farm, Ekerö, where his father was a security guard. And on that farm was Rosalund, also called Ekelund. Anna followed his lead and used the Ekelund surname. Her material grandfather had a unique surname, Lickstein, that he used from his father. But Anna's mother did not follow her father's example, and she and all her siblings reverted back to patronymics, using Lars, daughter or son. The name Lickstein holds a bit of mystery. During the Napoleonic Wars, a Joseph Lickstein flag bearer born in Slovakia in 1770, came to Sweden and worked as a hussar and a runner, a flygear for the King of Sweden. He had a number of sons who worked as runners, and one of them may have been Anna's grandfather, Lars Lickstein. He was born in Slovakia, so we now know that our Makoska family has Middle European ancestry on both our mother's and our father's side of our tree. Great-grandpa Olander provided a prime example of why the Swedes finally outlawed patronymics. Initially, grandpa used Olsen as his last name because his father's first name was Ola. But before he left Sweden, he changed it to Olander because he was the younger or second son. Cousin Echo discovered that Olander means other or second, indicating the other Olsen. Look carefully at the family tree, and you'll see that Eric and Martin had three older brothers who died at a very young age. Grandpa Martin was born in Stora Köpingen and great-grandma Dorothea in Rödinge, about as far south in Sweden as you can get. All of Martin's traceable ancestors back to the 1500s were born, lived, and died in either Malmöhus or Kristianstad counties, which merged to form Skane County in 1997. So, how did our Swedish great-grandparents get here? Family history plus Swedish and American records show that Martin first crossed to America on the Teutonic by passing through Liverpool and landing in New York in 1890. He was one of almost 500,000 Swedes who migrated here between 1879 and 1893. He followed those who traveled on to Western Pennsylvania, one of the densest settlements of early Swedish immigration in America. However, 3 years later, Martin returned to Malmö, became engaged and married Anna Ekelund in February of 1893, and that May sailed back to America on a more luxurious ship, the City of New York. The first time Grandpa Martin crossed the Atlantic, he listed his occupation as laborer, but the second time he claimed he was a sailor. The couple was back in Mount Jewett, Pennsylvania by November, Martin clearly had family on his mind because 9 months after the wedding, Alfilda was born. In the first 14 years of their marriage, they had 7 children. In Mount Jewett, Grandpa Martin built a large home with 5 bedrooms upstairs and a large kitchen, dining room, parlor downstairs. Here's Mary Jean telling about the house and about Grandpa and Grandma's relationship.
I don't know how Grandpa got the money to get such a nice house and had, you know, all these children and finally wouldn't sleep with him anymore. And she really didn't love him at all. And she thought he was, of course, kind of a lower class person, and she was dainty and feminine. And I never could talk to her because she spoke Swedish. I never talked to her 10 words.
Uncle Martin gives us another take on how they got along.
Grandpa was sort of ladies' man. And one day he came in his horse and buggy, and he had a lady friend with him. And Grandma grabbed a hold of that horse and buggy, went after him.
6 of Grandpa's children married, and all of the girls never left Pennsylvania. The oldest, cousin Lorraine's mother, Alfield, wrote a story about Grandpa Olander and his brother, Eric Olson. Both were blacksmiths. The difference in their last names made it easy for people in Mount Jewett to remember which blacksmith should shoe their horses. In this story, Grandpa always shod the heavier works horses, resting the horse's leg against his left knee. Over the years, that leg became bent and crippled. Our Olander family was close to cousins Martha, Lorraine, and Jeanette. Martin remembers a colorful story about cousin Jeanette.
Well, Uncle Carl, because he was a bricklayer, he didn't have a job that he could go to every day. So he had to go around and find work. Aunt Elfield was pregnant with Jeanette. I guess he found a big job in Jeanette, Pennsylvania. And he worked down there in Jeanette, and they were so celebratory about it that he wanted to call Jeanette, give her the name Jeanette for that city.
Martha was everyone's favorite cousin.
You know, she was 6 feet tall, and her daughters were all tall, and she's always fun and full of jokes. Martha and Ward were good pals, and all of Ward's friends were good friends with Martha because she smoked and drank, and you know, she was one of the boys. Mount Jewett, for every holiday, regular thing to go and visit your parents and your sisters. And of course, he had 6 sisters, and they all lived within very close range. Their family was all there, and the house was a nice big white colonial house.
Mary Jean and Martin remember Olga, the second sister.
Aunt Olga worked for the Canes, and they lived in Quishiqua, down about 2 miles in the valley below Mount Jewett. She was like a housemaid. They paid her well because she worked for them for years. She would come on the weekends and fix the meals for Grandpa.
And Elida, the fourth, always called Ida.
Elida, okay, who lived over in Corey. I didn't know too much about her. She married Uncle Harry. The only thing we knew about Uncle Harry was he was diabetic. He was a nice guy.
Elvira is the least remembered of the Olander aunts, perhaps because she had no name on her birth certificate, filed a month after her birth on New Year's Day, 1906. When she was baptized on March 17th, she became Elvira Theodora.
Held everybody in the dining room, and the children all ate in the kitchen, and we had a great time. And then after dinner, after everything was cleaned up, always had music and the piano in the parlor, and Herbert had to sing because they were all waiting for him. And Aunt Alma played the piano and he sang. And I always stayed for that because I loved that.
But Aunt Alma, you know, she took in boarders and she, boy, great cook. And Uncle Carl was, he worked for a you know, beverage company in Wilcox. And Aunt Alma said when the pop company left, Uncle Carl didn't go to work again.
But Aunt Ellen, his sister, had us, Daddy and us, to her house every single Saturday night. We played cards, and George was so much fun. He was a lovely man and a good sense of humor. And we'd all just sit around and laugh and carry on. And I know my father couldn't have gotten through it if it hadn't been for his sister.
Uncle George was a, where they had a glass factory that they'd get huge sheets of glass, so big that you could barely grab them, turn them out, put them on a table, and then cut them.
Grandpa Martin is surrounded by stories.
Well, of course, he was a blacksmith. You have a picture of the blacksmith shop there. And then he all worked in a tannery in Mount Jewett. He was, old and chewed snuff and, you know, funny little words, oyster for Easter. You know, he talked with a very broken English. And us kids used to laugh about all the different, you know, ways he pronounced. But I do remember as a kid, I used to come in and I'd see his glasses. He had these big, thick glasses and they were all scratched and everything. And then that's the way he read.
In 1954, when our family drove from Berea to Mount Jewett to celebrate his 90th birthday, I remember Grandpa sitting at a card table, shouting Trump or no Trump.
And one thing I remember about Grandpa when he died, he had the biggest smile on his face. But that reminded me of Grandpa. That's what Grandpa was all about. You know, he had a nice personality and they had him laid out. And what they did was the funeral directors in those days, they had a show window. And they would, these small towns, they just lay him out right in the show window so everybody could see him.
Grandfather Herb, or as we always knew him, Poppy, grew up in Mount Jewett, born third in the midst of six sisters, none of whom went to college. Sons had preference with regard to education. Daughters simply married and became homemakers. In 1915, Poppy left Pennsylvania to enroll at Augustana College in Rock Island, Illinois.
He went to Augustana. He went there with Grandpa wanting him to be a preacher. He thought about being a doctor at one time, and then he went into teaching.
In October 1918, Herb was a student in training for the Army, but was released in December, shortly after World War I ended. There is a glowing description of him in his senior class Augustana yearbook. A very tall and slender man with eyes of piercing brown, all Augie claims with one accord, a better scout's not known. Herb was not eager to return to Mount Jewett.
I don't think he wanted to go back to Mount Jewett that often because he'd be back in the blacksmith shop.
He had a bowl haircut?
Probably Grandma cut it for him, right, for the bowl. I think Grandpa paid his way out there because, that, you know, the girls didn't get anything. The boy was the one who was given the education.
He took a job at Tatonka, Iowa. There, he taught physics and manual training for 2 years at Buffalo High School, where he was also the superintendent. He kept a wonderful picture album and was so well-liked that the students dedicated the yearbook to him. Hallie Ward and her first cousin, Nancy Ferguson, known then by her middle name, Marie, attended Iowa State Teachers College. Hallie graduated first in 1917 and taught in Birmingham, Alabama, and then in Walker, Minnesota. She met Herb in Cedar Rapids in the summer of 1920 when they were taking classes. He roomed at Hallie's mother's boarding house in Cedar Falls on West 24th Street. Here is Aunt Nancy's description of how Hallie met Herb.
The house where we were having our house party mm-hmm. was on a bank that was about, 9, 10, maybe 12 mm-hmm. feet, right straight up from the river. So the problem was, where would they put the canoe? As was quite often the case, your grandmother had very strong ideas as to how that should be done. Mm-hmm. So she went out and began to help them and tell them what to do. Well, in order to help them better, your grandma went down through the little narrow path and on the little tiny edge. And she was down at the back of the canoe because she always was willing to help and put her hands and her strength in. Herb was down where she was, and she mm-hmm. was helping lift it. And Paul, his friend,
the other
was pulling mm-hmm. up at the top, and in order to make it go a little better, he pushed it back a little to get it started up better. Mm-hmm. And he didn't know that Hallie was there, and he pushed her right into about 8 feet of water. And she had been dressed and combed and just beautiful. And she just came up dripping. And when your grandma was angry, she could really lay anyone out with her tongue. And she came up that path dripping, her hair hanging down and mm-hmm. dripping. And she told Paul Youngberg what she thought of him. I think Herb was more amused, although he kept a straight face. Mm-hmm. The summer was over, I was going to school, Hallie mm-hmm. was going to wherever she was going to teach. Herbert began writing to me. I remember, I thought Herbert wrote such good letters, they mm-hmm. were so newsy. But if we ever were together, I was playing Herb's accompaniments. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And he sang, and he loved to sing. And so that 9/3 of my time, they were both there, mm-hmm. and I was playing Herb's accompaniments. Because we had a piano in the parlor.
Uncle Ward and Martin both claim that Hallie stole Herb from Nancy.
Nancy and she were both very interested in my father. And she said she was going to get him because he had a good body. And, you know, she's a farm girl. They look at teeth. She looked at Shirley's teeth before we married.
Yeah, go ahead.
Aunt Nancy claimed that Mother stole Herb from her. And I guess Aunt Nancy was just a little slow on the uptake.
When I first came to New York City, I lived with Aunt Nancy for a year. Knowing what I know about Aunt Nancy, if Hallie really believed Nancy was chasing her, Hallie was either using her imagination to brag that she was the winner, or our Granna simply didn't understand that Nancy was never inclined to romantic relations with a man.
That she came home one that summer, and she said she had decided she was going to get another degree, and she was going to the University of Wisconsin to get it. She said, it's time I got married. You decide, and you get married. And I said, so that's why you're going to Madison. Well, she said, I'm going to get married. And I said, well, do you know who the lucky man is? And she said, no, she didn't know.
In September of 1922, Hallie refused a teaching job in Boston to follow Herb to the University of Wisconsin. There, they both were students, and school records show that 6 months before they married, they lived together at 124 Breeze Terrace.
And I can remember my father saying, he had her picture, and the landlady said to him, boy, she's a pretty girl. It's that picture we have of Weather. Why don't you go after her? And he said, well, he wasn't sure.
But she went to Wisconsin, and it wasn't very long before I found out, and I think she had known it all along, that Herb was going to go to Wisconsin, too. Oh.
Hallie was a liberated woman, and at age 28, she was eager to get liberated into marriage. Hallie and Herb's marriage licenses dated Valentine's Day, 1923, and they were quick to start a family. That same year, Mary Jean was born on December 6th in Ypsilanti, Michigan. For 5 years, Herb taught at Michigan State Normal School. After Ward was born in June of 1928, the family moved to the University of Chicago, where Herb received a second PhD in education. Then, in August 1929, the family moved to Johnstown, Pennsylvania, where Herb taught at a branch of the University of Pittsburgh. It was the beginning of his long teaching career in the Pitt University system. Because of his height, for many years, he proudly led the Pitt graduation ceremonies. While the family did not move to Pennsylvania until 1929, I have no doubt that Hallie met Herb's family in Mount Jewett before they married in 1923. Our Grandma developed a strong connection with the Olanders, evident in the naming of Aunt Alfilda's third daughter, Hallie Lorraine Bengston, born in 1926.
All of my father's sisters made a big thing out of mother, out of my mother. They just thought she was the cat's whiskers. She knew everything. She could talk to anybody, you know. She knew, if she didn't know it, she'd make it up. And she was a good cook, and oh, they always talked about her. Oh, your mother, she could sew, she could do everything, you know. And she would just entertain and cook, and they just thought the world of her. And Lorraine, who sent a picture of her wedding, and she asked my mother to pour tea at her wedding for the reception. Her name is Hallie Lorraine, because they just thought she was this lovely bride of their brother. She never had any prejudice about any nationality. The fact that the family didn't speak English, that didn't bother her a bit.
A sign, all the aunts said. The best one was your mother. Well, she was tough. She made everybody toe the line, you know? She didn't have any guff, and if she thought something, she said it. And the aunts respected that. They told me that many a time. Hannah and Uncle George, they lived in a house. You know, they would just keep renting. They would have rented until they died. My mother got up there and she says, what's the idea of throwing all that money away in rent? You know how mother was. Don't throw that money away, buy this house. And sure enough, she got them to buy the house.
In July of 1931, the family moved into the manor.
And then Grandma talked these owners of this DuPont mansion that was sitting there in the Depression with nothing happening to it.
It was empty, and my mother went after them. She said her husband was at the university, and she would take care of the mansion if they would give us free rent. Probably she asked for money too.
In Johnstown, Mary Jean remembers an early sign of difficulties between Hallie and Herb.
And I remember one time when they were fighting. This was on, Ward was just 2 years old or something. And she was, they were trying to get ready for a picnic, and she got so mad she just threw the bread all over everything and cried and went upstairs. And Poppy was just, you know, peaceful, picking up the sandwiches and putting them all together. And he never was a fighter.
They eventually divorced, but they were very much in love during the first years they were married.
So I think that although she was very intelligent, drew them together, their intelligence. And you know, he was a very kind man. He was a soft male, very, very kind, a big heart.
Although I think my father idolized her up until she went to the hospital.
We've heard many stories about the manor, making life there sound quite glamorous.
Maybe we're in the manor for 3 years.
It must have been 15 or 20 acres.
A big living room in the mansion. And I would ride my tricycle around the halls.
They had a swimming pool, a real upscale place. And they had a stable. They could ride their horses. and it was all countryside.
They would take turns having the horsey crowd in for brunch on Sunday. They'd go out early and have a ride all around, and then they'd go to one place and people would serve the lunch. In the fall, when the hunting season would start, there was all kinds of pheasants. I can remember my dad looking out of the window, that bathroom window, and still in his shorts, and getting the gun and shooting a pheasant. By the time he got his pants on and went down to get the pheasant, the Burgess came in his car to say you weren't allowed to shoot in the... So then Daddy would give him a bird and he'd go away. And so we always had on the top of the piano, we always had a vase full of pheasant feathers. The first radio that we had, and this radio was on legs, and it got some sort of a prize for being a beautiful piece of furniture. It's a majestic radio. And so he sat right in the middle of the living room floor, and everybody gathered around to listen to the radio.
In August of 1932, Uncle Martin was born.
This was before Grandma went to the hospital, and she was pregnant the last year that the manor, and he was born in August.
My mother had Martin in the manor. Doctor came and delivered the baby.
I remember when he was just 3, 2 and a half, he would be in his playpen and they'd push himself against the playpen and sing. And the neighbors would all come, the kids would all come and say, sing the Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean, sing. Row, row, row your boat. And, you know, I'm sure it was because my dad sang all the time and we were taught to sing.
Mary Jean and Martin have deep memories of a black man, Huey Miller, who lived with the family for 8 years.
And Huey, well, he came to us in Johnstown. And Mother went down into the colored section, or met him, and he needed a job. And so he came to the manor after the Nathaniel ran away with the girl, the white girl, we had a black man that had helped us with the horses, and so Mother had to replace him, and she got Huey. And he had been born, I think, in Tennessee or Arkansas or someplace, and he lived with his sister in Johnstown, and wasn't married and never had any children. So he came out and stayed with us, and I mean, he wasn't an old man at all. And put Huey in the white jacket, and when we had company, he would serve. And she had a little button underneath the table that she'd call him, and he'd come in.
I think I remember he showed us his sixth finger. He had a little finger growing out. He showed us that.
And with his extra thumb hot, he wouldn't let her have it taken off. He would work maybe for a month, and then he'd have a week off. And he would dress up and smell good and put on something sharp, and oh, he looked so handsome when he went home. But I'd say, oh, you're going to go have a date. He says, I ain't thinking about you. And he never would fight or never answer back. He'd just say, I'm not thinking about you.
Hallie's mental deterioration began in 1933. And in June, they moved to a smaller house, Somerset Pike Farm. In August, Hallie finally broke down completely.
He was going to take her to the hospital, and he held her down with, you know, her wrists all night long while she raved. And Ward and I remember that. We were together in the bedroom. She was writing a play about Oberammergau, and she was going to write a passion play, you know. So then in the morning, he took her to the hospital, and she was in for 3 months. And after that, he couldn't pay for any more.
The doctors advised my father that she was not going to get any better, put her in an institution.
And the doctors really didn't know what to do, that they could give her shock treatments and so forth. So she did go to Torrance, which was in Blairsville, and she was there for 3 years.
After a year, Hallie was improving and wanted to leave the hospital.
He could bring her home. And he said no, he couldn't bring her home because he had a young family and it would affect the young family.
Wrote to her sister in Iowa, said, I gotta get out of here.
So she wrote to her sister, Mary, and Uncle Will paid to send Mary on the train.
Hallie emerged from the hospital with the white hair that we all remember. Because Herb wouldn't take her back,
he said, you can take Mary Jean, but I'll take the boys.
Mary Jean went back with her and went to school.
Felt like my father was giving me away. And here was this woman I hadn't seen for 3 years that I had to go live with.
When Herb and Hallie lived in Ypsilanti, they became very close to Cy, who taught with Herb and his wife, Rena.
And she got a lot better. And the nurses out there said that he could bring her home. Of course, she was unhappy, and the nurses befriended her, and they told her that if she had a family, any other family would come and get her, she could be discharged. Got mother out of the hospital. He said, you can't take her out unless you have a place to keep her. And Mary said, well, I'll take her home. Aunt Rena and Uncle Cy, they were friends of my parents, who I called them aunt and uncle from Ypsilanti, called Herb and said, you can't do this to your family. Mother took a bus from Iowa to Ypsilanti. I suppose Daddy drove. After they were there for the weekend, they called and said they were going to try to work it out and live together.
But he took her back as strictly, not even a friend, someone who lived with us in the family. It was not a good situation for kids.
In the spring of 1936, the reunited family sold the horses and the Dunkel house and moved to the Pallister house in Pittsburgh. Hallie had hired Huey at the manor in Johnstown, and he stayed with the family when they moved to Pittsburgh. Huey Miller was born in Jackson, Georgia in July 1899. And in the 1940 census of the Olander household, he's described as white, receiving $260 in houseman wages. No doubt that our grandma was stretching the truth.
So Huey was our caretaker, chief cook and bottle washer, and he slept on the basement.
At Denniston, he had a heart attack died. He was shoveling snow outside.
Life changed after Herb and Hallie decided, for the sake of the children and for Herb to keep his teaching position, to remain together.
Well, she was heartbroken, and I'm sure she thought that they would get back together again. They never did. They didn't talk hardly at all, and I was the go-between. I mean, I always felt like I was my father's daughter and loved him because I knew him all the time of my life. He was always in the house when I was young. He was always your father, not my husband, but your father. So then I would wangle around and I would try to get him to take us to the movies, and he usually did, you know.
While the two of them lived in the same house, they went their separate ways. Herb was the source of family funds, and he put Hallie on a strict budget. They lived together legally, but effectively they were separated.
He had to wash his hands. She had to weasel everything she could get out of him. And she bought some food, and probably he gave her money for the food, I don't know. It was not a good situation. But he wasn't there very much. He had evening classes in these little towns, two or three times a week, and they get some money out of that.
The children were growing up.
I remember one night, the ice was terrible on the street. It was really slippery in Johnstown. Ward ran out and a car hit him, and he just stiffened up and the car just pushed him along the ice. Somebody said, oh, that was your brother. Aren't you glad that nothing happened to him? And I thought, what are they talking about? I just assumed that he died. How is that? You know, that's how you think when you're not happy with your brother.
You know, Mary Jean was a teenager, maybe in college. Mother was hanging the wash down in the cellar, and I guess they had some words. It got into a fight, and they were actually fighting down in the cellar. And this is the way it was, you know. And Mary Jean was doing something else, you know, having her little girls' club smoking on the side. She was at the age where she always wanted a car. They got her a car, a nice little toy car.
Martin was most impacted, first by Hallie's breakdown, and then when his parents lived in an independent, cold marriage.
After she got Martin into school, changed him from a left-handed to a right-handed, and she felt that was what she should do, that because he would never be a first-class citizen if he didn't have a right hand. He failed the first year of school, I think it was, and so then he was okay after that.
Personally, I feel Mary Jean and Ward looked down on Martin, which Mary Jean should have realized from this story she told me.
He disappeared one day, and here he was going to the tennis courts to find Dad, and he had walked, this little kid walked the whole way and found his way. And to think that he knew just from going in the car over there. And I remember one of the things that happened was Daddy used to go and play tennis every Saturday, and how to get there. But, you know, Ward never really he was 4 years older, and it was like he never was interested in somebody younger, and I wasn't either.
Hallie worked her way up to become a minor Pittsburgh real estate mogul. But first, she had to raise enough capital to get started. In effect, Herb forced her to become an independent businesswoman, and she loved it.
And so that was why Granna was amazing, because she couldn't really get a job, an ordinary job.
When we moved to Squirrel Hill, she started selling coffee. The Jewel Tea Company had a system of female managers who would train people to go to houses and sell them coffee. So my mother trained women to do that, and she did it herself. She had to bring the coffee with her, knock on the door, invite herself in, made the coffee. They had a pound of coffee every 2 weeks or so.
They gave you a container that measured out the coffee just one cup at a time. A delivery man would bring you the coffee every week that you needed, like a bread route.
She graduated from that. Guardian Service is a cast aluminum cookingware. It looks good enough that you can serve at the dining table. She sold families a dinner, and those families had to invite a half a dozen prospects. She'd take Mary Jean with her, make the dinner, and then sell them the Guardian Service. The household got a free piece. Mary Jean had to do all the dishes, but my mother got more and more independent. She went from Guardian Service to the New Bone Company. Of course, it got a bunch of women together that went door to door selling courses. Teach the women how to sell. Their shtick was flexible. It was much more comfortable to dig into you.
After high school, Mary Jean and Ted decided to get married, which was sudden and questioned by Herb and Hallie.
I got married, and they always said, well, they didn't. There was nobody they'd rather have me marry than Ted, but I was too young. So we decided we were gonna get married, and I had the invitations printed and decided on the date and everything and brought them home and showed them to her. She's her only daughter, and she didn't have any of the fun of wedding plans. And we were married at the little Episcopal church in Squirrel Hill. And then we had a little reception at the house. I made brownies, and I think we had a couple kinds of cookies, and I wasn't going to invite anybody, and Ted said, oh, he had to invite his family. And then when they came and there was no liquor, they had to go out and get some liquor. That was terrible, you know, faux pas, not having something that they could drink. It was raining. Oh, it was a terrible day. And we stood on the porch.
Of course, Mary Jean got married while I was up there, because they didn't want me around, you know, when the wedding was going on. When I came back, Mary Jean gave me a piece of her wedding cake. I remember that.
I said we could live in my room. To me. Anyway, it was a bathroom and a bedroom together on Wallingford.
Shortly after Mary Jean and Ted's August wedding at the Wallingford house, which Herb and Hallie had rented, it was sold. Because they had to quickly move out, Herb and Hallie finally decided that it was time to divorce.
Well, I think the main reason they stayed together was until I got old enough. Let's get the divorce. So, and they fought. You know, even after the divorce, they were fighting. You know, they just couldn't see eye to eye coming around that they could talk to each other and be friends. you know, I was going back and forth, Daddy for a year, and then I'd come back. And I was poor in school. That's when I went back to Mother's. Of course it went better because the schools, Pittsburgh schools, were a lot easier than the suburb schools. I was in the upper two-fifths of my class.
They decided to get a divorce, I guess, and that didn't come through till the next year, but they separated, and Daddy took the two boys out to Oakmont and rented a little house out there. Granna, she got $2,000 or something like that settlement for all those years. She put it down on a house on Dithridge.
Before marrying, Ward and Martin had some lively years as bachelors. Uncle Herbert Ward used his mother's maiden name, Ward, just as Granna's favorite uncle, Freeman Lau, used his mother's. Freeman often visited the Thomas Ward family, so Hallie followed her uncle's lead to hold on to the memory of her maiden name. Uncle Ward's relationship with his mother evolved as he grew up.
We were afraid of her. We were very much afraid of her. And of course, then when Ward got big enough to give her what for, she had to quit. And he was the only one that ever could handle her, you know.
And everything she wanted, she got. And she would push Martin and I around a lot. One time, I got fed up with this, and she was really after me. And I grabbed her and slammed her against the refrigerator. But I think she realized at that time that I wasn't going to take any shit anymore. She recognized the fact that I could slam her around the way I wanted, and I think she was proud of that. We had a different relationship after that time.
Before finally settling down, Ward took a memorable trip across Europe, including meeting some Olander Olsen relatives in Sweden. Cousin Holly assembled many of these letters he wrote to the family back in America. Whenever one arrived in our mailbox, we looked forward to Mom's dinner reading of Uncle Ward's European adventures. Uncle Martin told me much of his history when I spent a day with him and Bunny on Long Island. He collected rents from Granna's roomers, fought fires in the woods of Idaho, and became a classification specialist when in the Air Force. These are some of the stories he talks about in the videos I assembled. The Olander family tree would not be complete without background on Lucille Fox, or as Chris and I knew her, Aunt Lee. After Herb and Hallie finally settled their divorce, Poppy married Lee in May of 1946. Lee's branch has extensive Pennsylvania German roots. 100% of her father's origins and at least half of her mother's. Only Hallie Ward can claim deeper roots in colonial America. Lee's ancestors immigrated from Germany to Pennsylvania in the early 1700s, but her second great-grandfather, Benjamin Love, was likely from Ulster, Ireland, and immigrated with a second wave of Irish to Pennsylvania. He arrived just in time to be recruited into the Revolutionary War, and was one of her 8 second great-grandfathers who fought in our War of Independence. Both of Lee's grandfathers were drafted in the Civil War, fighting in Pennsylvania brigades of the Union Army. So let's look at how Poppy and Lee met. 7 years before their serendipitous meeting, my father, Ted, was an Eagle Scout in Pittsburgh. Dad's scoutmaster was Bill Babbitt, and they remained friends because they were Carnegie Tech graduates. It's unclear how Lee met and then married Bill in 1940. He was an accountant in Pittsburgh until he was drafted in October 1943. In June of 1944, he landed on D-Day with his infantry regiment in France, but was then killed by a sniper in July. Lee talked about Bill with her Uncle Ward, some of which my father confirmed.
She was the wife of Bill Babbitt. He was older than Ted, and they taught scouting, and he was gay. And so, back at a time when nobody talked about gays, but Lee told us afterwards.
After his death, Lee went to stay with Bill's family in Connecticut. Because my dad had been close to Bill, Ted and Mary Jean, who were living in nearby New London, also went to visit them on Cape Cod.
I thought about my dad and Lee. You know, was Ted's Boy Scout leader's wife. And she came to visit us in Connecticut after he died. She went to see Bill's folks who lived in Massachusetts. And so she went up to visit them after he died. And then she stopped in Connecticut, but she stayed with us. And all I said to her, I'm going to give my father your telephone number and have him call. He's lonesome, and I think he'd enjoy going out together. So I did. And that worked.
As you heard, Mary Jean decided that Poppy and Lee would make a perfect couple. And that winter, when she and Ted moved back to Pittsburgh, Mary Jean was pushing her father to get in touch with Lee.
When Lee came into the picture, Mary Daddy, she was up there too. They lived there on Kimball Street for a long time.
Lee was more of a mother than he was a father. He took us out to their club for dinner a couple of times.
At Chalfont, they had a piano, and we played that. We'd all sing, you know, in parts.
He tended to be stodgy. Every kid's dreaded question, how do you like school? To his credit, he tried. Lee, his wife, would rough and tumble with us and bite our ears and, you know, I think he was happy to have this young, pretty, fun thing on his side. I think she had a very strong sexual appetite, and I think he appreciated that. They had a real love, and when he passed, she had a hard time throwing away his dentures.
Mom often bragged about her matchmaking skills, and she registered her first success when Herb and Lee married in August of 1946. This, of course, is not the end of the Olander branch of our tree. Three more generations followed Herb and Hallie's three children. Adding up to, so far, 43 first, second, and third great-grandchildren. I will leave it to them to tell their stories. With our Olander history now recounted, only one quarter of the tree remains. Hallie Ward, our beloved Grandma's branch. As I've often said, her tree has much deeper roots in America. On Hallie's mother's side, we can count back 10 generations in America. She has roots in Ireland, Holland, England, and France. But first, we'll climb up Grandma's Father Tom's branch with stories about World War I, a wagon train across the plains, and the Civil War. So, until next time.